nice to give a clap even before I say anything. Okay, so folks, today I want to, in a sense, what I want to do is outline a series of questions. There are certainly questions that I work with all the time, and I'm assuming that because you've come here, many of these questions are questions that you're concerned about as well. And I think that your year here at the DPU offers you a real opportunity to explore some of these questions, and maybe by the end of the year to take some positions on them. So, I want to frame those questions with what I see as a really fundamental conundrum of development. The paradox of development, which is that we have, in fact, in the last century, created more wealth internationally in the world than we ever had in the previous centuries. And yet, we live with enormous inequalities in cities, in nations, and internationally, as we know, the geopolitical landscape internationally is almost also very, very unequal. And so, what we can see is that often the reality of many cities is, yes, we have a modern part of a city, looking into the distance there with modern office blocks as we know them, okay? But at the same time, cheek by jowl, a lot of our cities also have huge proportions of informal settlements. And so this seems to me to be a paradox of development that we need to understand a bit better, and B, I would say that it poses a challenge for the collective endeavor that it attempts to try to address this with the intention of making it better, and one of those vehicles for doing that is in fact planning. Oh, that's how I would see planning in any event, okay? Now, this is a word that is used in many different ways by different people. So I want to start right now by asking you, what do you understand by planning? What's planning? Some of you come here to register in a course called Urban Development Planning. So, what's planning? Any ideas? Yeah?
Thinking ahead,
okay. So there's some kind of future orientation to it, yeah? What else?
Feasibility study
to do what? So you do feasibility studies to decide on what project you want to do. Okay, what else? You want to say something? Formulate plans for the future. Okay, again, future oriented. Yes.
Set a goal, find a path to that goal, and how to
achieve that goal. That's it? Okay. Great. What else?
Prevent a future problem.
I can't hear.
Prevent a future problem.
Prevent future problems. So that's slightly interesting spin on our future, okay? Our future is not just nice and simple and easy constructed, but there might be quite serious problems coming. Okay, what else? I'll see another hand here. Yes, thank you for mentioning that. You can't do all this wonderful stuff without resources, of which money is one, but it's not the only one, okay? Okay, what else? Is there anything else that's a feature of planning that you can think of? Yes?
Design who will be involved.
Absolutely. And what else? Yes?
Evaluation.
Evaluation of what?
Of the plan and its effectivity through to get to the goal you actually start you want to reach.
Okay, so that means that you're accepting that actually going to the future isn't a simple, straightforward exercise. We better keep track of what's actually happening. Even though we might have terrific goals, we may not actually end up reaching them. So we need to keep track of that. Okay, process, yes.
And mobile has the power of different actors, national, international, local.
Okay, so it's not just a matter of involving them, but mobilizing them, which I think is an important difference. Yes.
Thinking of risk.
Okay, it's like that future challenges question we had there. Yes, absolutely. We know the world is certainly not risk-free, and the reality is that it's not just about future challenges, it's also we know that today large proportions of populations live with risks of all kinds.
Yeah.
Okay, anything else? Anything else we haven't touched on that you think is really important to this idea?
Constraints.
Constraints. What about constraints?
Constraints. When you look at things climbing ahead holistically, you have to cut it and find the constraints. It could be climate, it could be cost, it could be cultural, traditional.
Okay, so we're getting a sense that actually planning isn't a simple linear process. Yeah, that you think about the future, you have a goal, and off you go, and you reach this goal. That there may be some constraints along the way which we need to try to factor in. Okay, now, as you can imagine, there are huge, huge amounts of discussions about this issue, which we're going to touch on in the coming year. And a lot of those issues also look at, which we've started to do a little bit, around what does the planning process look like. Somebody's talked about doing a feasibility study. Somebody said evaluation. Okay, so we're mobilizing actors. So we've got a sense maybe of a set of components which might make up this planning process. But of course, as you can imagine, there are in very many, many different ways and many, many different discussions describing and talking about what that planning process might look like. I could have chosen amongst many hundreds of definitions of planning. I found one that I thought was quite interesting, and it reflects a lot of what you've just said. Planning is linked to certain material and cultural processes. Maybe we didn't talk too much about that, but we started to. That is to say, the effort to shape urban and regional development pathways, so we've got an idea of trajectories, of futures, okay, through some deliberate, collective governance efforts. So when you see a definition like that, the focus on governance and the framework of governance puts you squarely into a political frame. So we're not talking here about planning as a technical exercise. Yeah? So this is just one definition by a very, very well-known planner, researcher in the field of planning, Patsy Healy, who I'm sure you're all going to get to know very well if you don't already know her work. And it starts to suggest some of the issues that we need to be looking at. Now, I would argue that part of those debates, we need to understand those debates in the big picture. And part of those debates depend on the intersection of at least these three things. On the one hand, we have theories and ideologies of what we think planning, how we understand cities in planning, and what we think it should be. Okay? And I use should in an ideological frame without deliberately, okay? Because planning is often a normative exercise. As I said, it's political, it's not necessarily technical. On the other hand, there's a lot of discussion about the how-to, the methodology. And the theory, supposedly, and methodology often feed into each other. They make sense to each other. And then, of course, the big circle is the practice, on the top, the practice of planning, but the practice of planning in very particular contexts. And I think that we need to start thinking about the intersection of these three areas so that we start to begin to put together a framework or a picture for understanding our positions and the positions of other people that we might engage with. Okay? Now, I think what we need to recognize is that when people take positions here, they usually have, or they almost, I would say almost always 100% have, whether it's explicit or implicit, they have a paradigm behind what they think. What do I mean by a paradigm?
A set of beliefs or a certain way of seeing things.
A set of beliefs, a certain way of seeing things. Anybody else?
Model.
A what?
A model.
An agenda.
Values.
A construction of what is good and what is not.
Okay, so we're talking about quite a broad-based thing. I want to present you with a definition by somebody who actually formulated this idea and is a much quoted theorist, actually in the natural sciences, but the definition has lived and been worked through in the social sciences as well. So here we have what some of you have said, a constellation of values and beliefs and perceptions of empirical reality, which together with a body of theory based on the foregoing is used by a group of scientists, you may or may not see yourself as a scientist, and by applying a distinctive methodology to interpret the nature of some aspects of the universe we inhabit. So it's a very, very broad understanding, but what it tells us is that whether we are conscious of it or not, we carry paradigms in our heads from the way we've been socialized, from our education, and some of us are very conscious of it and some of us aren't, and it leads us to say and do and think certain things, coming back to those three intersecting triangles, which therefore starts to show in the way you understand planning. In other words, the way you see that theory, methodology, and practice intersecting with each other. I would say that actually in the end it's more accurate to talk about plannings rather than planning, because I think there are lots of different positions on it. And I tend often just to call it planned intervention of some kind or other as well, just as an umbrella term. Now, in doing this, I think there's some critical debates that are very, very important to this idea of planning, because although we've talked about actors and mobilizing actors, we didn't actually mention any of those actors. And that is the crux, really, of this whole issue and what I want to spend the rest of the session on. I'd like to address three questions. How much and what kind of state involvement in planned intervention? How much and what kind of private sector involvement in planned intervention? And how much and what kind of civil society involvement in planned intervention? I think that these are pretty fundamental questions which have been answered in different ways based on different paradigms, different understandings of that intersection of theory, methodology, and practice. And I think when we start delving into these questions, they start to throw up lots of other questions, which I think at least you need to come up with some position on those questions in the year that you're going to be here at the DPU. Now, let me start with how much and what kind of state involvement in planning. And at the risk of being extremely simplistic, I think what we've seen is a series of debates which have looked at the state as a stimulator of development, using planning as the entry point for doing that, the state as a distributor of the goodies of development, and or the state as an enabler of development through planned intervention. And what one can say, if you look at the history of planning, is that the modern planning has largely been an activity of the state, even though there have been a lot of other actors involved, more or less involved over time. And I think we need to recognize that this debate has its roots in paradigms of economic development policy, and that these paradigms of economic development policy are often those paradigms promoted by developed countries and international agencies. In other words, these paradigms have been promoted by a so-called group of international experts, okay, which are then used as the basis to distribute and work with foreign aid in many different parts of the world. Okay? And so they've been extremely powerful. I say that because I think it's really important always to know where something comes from when you start to use something or you find something interesting. Find out where it comes from, okay? Because that's going to tell you something about that idea or that practice, which is very important. Okay? Now, let's have a look at what some of these ideas are. And I'm going to present them in a very simplified model. Somebody said a model here on this side. Okay, I'm going to present them in what are the classic economic development models. Okay, if we look at the state as stimulator in what become known as accelerated economic growth, what we see in the 1950s and 60s is a debate and a discussion about apparently what was facing international people working in development, traditional sector, and what they saw as creating a modern sector. So a very classic modernization kind of position. Okay? And the idea was we want to reduce the traditional sector, grow the modern sector. And how did they think about that? Well, one of the most important elements of that for them was actually the mechanization of agriculture and the investment in large-scale infrastructure. So we began to see in the 50s and 60s the growth and expansion of cotton plantations, groundnuts, coffee, tea, sisal. Okay, does anybody have other crops that come from your country produced? Sorry?
Corn.
Yes, absolutely.
Rice.
Yes, huge rice projects, massive rice projects. Okay, and the idea is through an investment in technology, in skills, in amalgamating land, okay, traditionally owned land, amalgamating it into large tracts of land, you can start to mechanize agriculture in a way that the theory goes that you increase the surplus. Right? And it's that surplus that generates
wealth.
Exactly. Right? And the idea is that planning should be intervening and supporting that process, and at the same time, it should also be investing in large-scale infrastructure like roads, railways, electricity,
bridges.
Okay. You know this model, right? Yes? It's familiar to you. The idea is that that process will start an acceleration of industrialization. And the idea is that industrialization will create jobs, waged employment, money jobs, okay? And that because of that creation of wealth, people will be drawn off, surplus labor will be drawn off into that kind of wealth-creating economy. And that means that people will have more income, money in their pockets, okay? Cash in increased numbers of households. And the idea is that, of course, if you have more money, you can buy things, right? To look after yourself and your family. And if you're lucky enough, you may even be able to save, right? For the future, savings become a very important point of discussion in economic debates. And the idea is that this will increase over time the welfare of all through exactly through trickle down, that this drawing into this modern economy over time will create a trickle down approach. And the idea is because it trickles down, it feeds back into the process of industrialization. And that's the accelerated element of the growth, okay? that when more people have more money, they create demand, they want to buy more, that means we produce more. Okay, and so there is a kind of self-sustaining here, accelerated growth model. And of course, into this model, they began to introduce trade, which made the model more complex because we're not just talking about one place, but we're talking about the interaction of many places within a country and between countries. And into this process, of course, foreign aid put in through planning, policy making, it's initially anyway focused on the mechanization of agriculture and investment in large-scale infrastructure. Now, is this familiar? Yeah, it's a familiar model, even if you haven't seen this particular thing, but it's a familiar model, right? This is a kind of classic development model, okay? By the end of the 60s, beginning of the 70s, many development practitioners began to be disillusioned with this model for a number of reasons, okay? And they began to start to rethink the way development was working. The key reason that they were disillusioned with the model is that somehow what was happening was that the rich were getting richer and the poor appeared to be getting poorer and more, to put it very simply. Okay, now how did that start to work? Well, by the end of the 70s, there was a big debate that the focus of development not should be so much on this kind of accelerated growth, but we also need to introduce the idea of distribution in that process. Okay? In other words, we can't just assume that everything will trickle down, okay? That the state actually has to be actively involved in distributing some of that growth. So if we go into the next discussions, what we see is that a big body of people start working with the idea of distribution of growth and basic needs, centered primarily in the ILO, the International Labour Organization, but spreading to all the international agencies, starting to think about things in a slightly different way. And one of the things, of course, they began to look at and the reasons that they were unhappy with the model was that, in fact, there wasn't the creation of the amount of wage employment that people expected, okay? So there was a much low wage, low employment creation. And what we start to see, instead of surplus labor being drawn in, is actually a growth of informality. A growth of informality in the way people are living and in the way people are engaging with the economy, okay? We start to see the growth of informal settlements, but also the informal economy. And what emerges is a small elite who are doing very well, but growing expressions of poverty for the majority. In other words, as I said, trickle-down is not working. There's little or no trickle-down, trickle-down to very particular groups of people in the country. So the basic needs approach, the argument is, if this is the case, then planning and policy making needs to start to address some of these poverty issues. Okay? We can't just leave it to the market, to this model, and actually we can't just mechanize agriculture and invest in large-scale infrastructure and expect everything to be fine. Okay? And so we start to get a new kind of agenda. An agenda which focuses on employment creation, it focuses on basic needs. In other words, what kind of basic needs do people start to talk about?
Water,
education, health, electricity wasn't top of the list. No, it wasn't. What became before electricity was housing. Housing, okay, where people are living, yeah? Food, security of what? Of life, okay? Yes, and the idea was that if you had a set of basic needs which people wrote about, they articulated what they were, okay, that this would that, and if the state could actually ensure a minimum basic needs, then this model would be greatly strengthened. And the idea was to do that, and I know this is a dirty word in some places, okay, but to do that through subsidy. Okay, because in other words, to take from the rich and redistribute through programs of the state to the poor. Okay. Now, as we know, this model eventually also ran into trouble. And by the 1980s, we hit what today we just talk about as neoliberal policy. Okay. Everybody know what neoliberal policy is? Structural adjustment. Can somebody tell me what some of those issues were?
Less involvement.
One at a time. Just put your hand up so we can hear. Yes.
It was to do with, it used to do with market liberalism, market dominance, which I just meant, which was sort of war by other period, which is fair to stay out of the picture, move the markets in, and reduce the barriers to trade, international trade across borders.
Yes.
On the rest of it.
Okay, good. What else? Yes.
To adjust all the expenditure of the government to adjust the national account, normally all the expenses on social development are cut down.
Right, so there were sections of the national expenditure that were greatly reduced. So yes, there was reduction of the state, but in very particular areas. Okay, yes, what else? Yeah, the back.
There were basically policies dictated by IMF and World Bank to governments. In return for loans, these adjustments have to be made more towards understanding of Western economies.
Like right. Very, very important, because those policies didn't come out of nowhere. They were institutionalized in an international framework, development framework. Yes?
We were very much against any kind of protectionism.
Against any protectionism, right?
Privatization, like civic railways.
Right. Right, so privatization in terms of opening things to the market, reducing the state, became very, very important. And this country and many other countries went through the privatization of lots of the basic services that used to be under the control and in the hands of government.
Yes, but they were privatized because they weren't making any money. On the contrary, they were losing money and was being given. They had more debt and more debt than the government. It's not only that, getting a loan.
Yes. So this was one of the drives that led some people to take those positions, okay, to take positions that they did, okay? So, in effect, I think what happened was that we returned to this model, but the state was not there as a stimulator, but we started to develop a new language, which is, we start to hear this word enabler. Enabler, okay? And in effect, what it means is the state is an enabler of the market, okay? And in effect, this is the model that we're left with. Today, we play with this model, we discuss it, we debate it, we push it around, we have many things to say about it. I want to raise three further questions which I think we need to start thinking about. The first relates to the form and the level of planned intervention by the state. What is clear is that through those three very distinct periods of time, there have been very different approaches to the form and the level of the state. In the accelerated growth model, we see national and regional planning of large-scale projects to stimulate growth. And from a planning perspective, that's largely been about physical planning. Building bridges, building roads, building electricity, building all the things that people believe are essential to the core of development. In the basic needs program, we see a shift in the way the form and the level of planning is thought about. Suddenly, planning moves from this kind of national scale, and we start to see something happening at an urban and local scale. Okay? And in the 60s and particularly the 70s, we start to see the basic needs program starting to be localized in spatial development programs through that are trying to distribute the benefits of growth. And I would say that yes, physical planning is still there in the design of housing, water, and sanitation. This is the era of self-help housing, sites and service projects, upgrading programs, okay, begin to grow and flourish in this time. And at the same time, what we need to what planners start to recognize is that in all this economic speak, communities are important. And so in fact, one of the basic needs, which we didn't pick up previously, is that included in the discussion of basic needs is the issue of participation, of the participation of communities. It's actually identified as one of the basic needs. And so we start to see the expansion of social planning to start to think about how you work with communities and community development programs. And in fact, what's really interesting is alongside the housing programs that you start to see, you see also community development workers working with architects, okay, in building and developing housing of different kinds, okay, with communities. And of course, from the economic point of view, economic planning, we see the focus on employment creation as well. A lot of discussion of small-scale enterprises, micro-enterprises, how you develop, how you push, you know, you develop or you promote the creation of employment in different ways. In the structural adjustment era, we go back to the kind of macroeconomic policy. Okay, so we go back from the sort of local involvement up back into macroeconomic policy and market enablement. And you start to get different kinds of vehicles emerging, different forms and levels. Legislation for privatization. You need some kind of framework to privatize something like the telephone system. You can't just do it like that. You have to create a whole regulatory framework which never existed before, in order to do those kinds of things. And in that regulation, we start to see new roles and relationships emerging, okay, in the way different actors relate to each other. We see the use of policy dialogue at the macro level being used more and more. The management of more fragmented localities due to privatization and involvement and community involvement. In other words, at the city level, because so many things are being privatized, actually, within the city, there's a huge fragmentation of services. Okay? The challenge for planning is quite different from what it used to be. Okay? Not everything is in the control of the state, and the local state doesn't have a lot of resources, it doesn't have a lot of skills, and it's meant to be implementing some national vision, okay, of structural adjustment and how to do that. These are huge challenges. And we also see a new generation of a new vehicle. In other words, the counter to structural adjustment becomes policy reduction strategies. Okay? We see new language trying to develop new kinds of vehicles for addressing the challenges of development. So I think that we have, of course, the debate about these things continue, but the important question here is, for us, is whose model of development are we going to be working with? You need to take a position on that, okay? How much redistribution by the state is necessary? That's a huge question, okay? I have a picture here of a toilet block in a slum in Pune, in India. It's funded jointly by the state and by communities. So what combination, what kind of combinations of relationships do we think are important here? And of course, a very important question, redistribution of what and to whom and at what level are we talking about there? Okay? We can have a debate about each one that will take us the whole afternoon. Okay? But I think these are questions you need to think about and develop some position. I want to go to a second question, which I think is really important in this discussion of the state, of what is state involvement. The so-called neutrality of the state and planned intervention by the state. For a long time, people went around believing that the state was a neutral intervener in development processes. And I think when we look at the economic growth paradigms in liberal political theory, particularly that economic growth model paradigm that I started with, there's a very strong assumption that the state is neutral, or at least somehow representative of all the interests in society, that it represents everybody and therefore it can act on behalf, it can act collectively. Of course, there are other paradigms which have challenged this enormously. So for example, the Marxist paradigm has shown through lots of different studies and ways of explaining reality that in fact, in many cases, the state is not neutral, that it actually acts in the interest of certain classes in society. Okay? And that debate has been taken much further in the postmodern paradigms, which actually show that the interests of the state are not just class-based, but they intersect with different social identities. In other words, we can see the intersection of class, gender, with ethnicity, with age, other social identities, which actually defy the idea that the state is neutral. Actually, the state often ends up acting in a combination of interests, an intersection of interests, based on these different social identities. So I think that at least the important questions here is to begin to recognize what are the interests and biases manifest in the practices of planned intervention by the state? And how can the state mainstream diversity in planned interventions? You know, how can the state start to actually reflect the diversity of its people? Diversity in terms of, yes, class, but also gender, ethnicity, age, etc., whatever the diversity of people is. And this is a question that at least since the 70s, national and international discussions have tried to take seriously in different ways. Okay, we've had the first UN decade on the advancement of women was 1976. Okay, so we've been talking a lot about gender since 1976. If you start looking at the diversity of work done on ethnicity, particularly in the last 15 years, enormous variety of work. And of course, questions of age, of youth, of the elderly, aging populations, what you do with young people in different contexts. We have programs within government, within international agencies that try to address this diversity, sometimes well, sometimes with great constraints. I think these are questions we need to think about, okay? Now, I come to the private sector. And of course, when I come to the private sector, I don't turn my back on the state, because we're talking about a relationship here, okay? And what we can see in the early models of development, that planned intervention was there to stimulate or to create private sector employment. In other words, the private sector was seen as the object of planning, okay? It was there to kind of, you know, improve it, strengthen it. And we see all in these different roles that I've talked about, as stimulator or as creator of employment or as enabler, in different ways, the private sector was encouraged and hopefully in the ideas of each of these paradigms, supported and developed and strengthened. Of course, today we live in a very different context, a changing context. We live in a globalized world where we see systems of production and consumption and distribution operating internationally in very, very different ways. We start to see parts of the world that actually try to mimic this accelerated growth theory through industrialization, suddenly faced with deindustrialization. Okay. So for example, a city like Mumbai, which was very highly industrialized around the textile sector, has in the last 15 years totally deindustrialized. Okay. With huge implications for the economy of that city and for the state and obviously for India, given the contribution that Mumbai makes to the Indian state. We're faced, of course, with all kinds of indications of economic crisis, credit crunch, and I'm not going to go into the details of that. The way we understand it, the way we define it is really, really very important, and I hope we're going to discuss a lot of those issues in the coming year. I think what's also interesting is that we've seen a massive globalization of governance of the private sector over those 30 years, and becoming stronger in some ways, weaker in other ways. In other words, WTO, what's that stand for? World Trade Organization. That? Yes, General Agreement on Trades and Tariffs. Okay, so this is all about international trade, which is really, really important about levels of, we talked about protectionism being thrown out, but this is about levels of protectionism. Who's protected, who isn't protected, what the tariffs are, etc., etc. And this change in context is really very important. And I would say, important questions here is, what is the role of the state and the private sector in the stimulation and the creation of employment? That's really not very clear. And recently, in many ways, the state has just lifted its hands and it said, the market will do that. Okay? But we also know that the market doesn't always do that in a particular way. So what role can the state play in that process? And what can be done at local, at national, at international level? Given that we have these globalizing economies, that the city of São Paulo is today, has large parts of it that are actually connected to global economies, what kind of power does the local state have? Actually, to manage and plan economies at a city level. So there are huge challenges here to think through what can be done at different levels in order to bring about the kind of changes that we think might improve lives. I think that with structural adjustment, we've seen another face of the private sector. Not as the object, but almost as the subject. In other words, the private sector as a planner and provider of housing and services, all kinds of services, okay, through the privatization process. The private sector is the subject of planning, the private sector is the provider of services, supposedly in the interests of efficiency, okay, linked with the idea of the primacy of the market. I put a question mark next to that because after many years of working under that assumption, there are many instances where that idea has been questioned on the basis of research and evidence. And even promoters like the World Bank have had to withdraw from the idea that everything should be privatized and that everything will be efficiently done through privatization. We also have, through privatization, faced a real conundrum around the question of cost recovery, because obviously if you ask the private sector to get involved in something, the private sector works on the basis of the principle of profit. They're not going to do anything that will not bring a profit, and that's perfectly reasonable. That's what the private sector is. That's the kind of animal it is. So, of course, that means that you introduce into the process levels of cost recovery, and then, of course, we have to start thinking about, well, what has been the impact on that in terms of inequality? And there are a huge number of stories that we can tell here, which I'm not going to have time to do, but I'm sure you have your own stories. And then, of course, when you privatize services, that, yes?
I haven't seen a lot of literature saying privatization sorts or solves inequality. I mean, I've seen it talked about cost recovery, but who would argue that privatizing something would reduce inequality?
Nobody did. But the assumption was nobody talked about inequality. That's the issue. In the discussion of the market, people shelved the question of inequality, and the assumption was, to go back to the old days, was that if we privatized, we generated, we accelerated market growth, we would get
trickle down,
and then we wouldn't have to worry with inequality. But the reality is, in the studies that we've done in the last 15 years, we found that we can't just shelve it like that anymore. So in a way, we're starting to have the same discussions we had at the end of the 60s, but in a very different world. In a very, very different world. Okay? And similarly, we start to have discussions about privatization and political accountability, because those services that the state used to provide, previously, you could vote people in and out of office, or you could point fingers at politicians if things weren't happening. Now, if it's all privatized, what are the processes of accountability around those things? Okay? States have tried to work out various hybrids to deal with this, but they haven't always been successful. Yes?
What about social enterprises that provide service using their private resources?
Yes. So social enterprises has been a new form of private sector, which has emerged in a way in response to the failure of what some people saw as other questions. So yes, there have been, of course, inventions and new kinds of paths that people have put together. And what we've seen, talking about social enterprises, is much more civil society partnerships with the private sector. Okay. To fund large-scale development. But of course, the question we always need to ask ourselves is who's in control in that process and how does it work? But there are interesting examples of that. The important question here for me is, for example, under what conditions will banks fund low-income housing and infrastructure? Because private sector can't fund this on its own, it borrows. Right? So, this is not middle-class housing. This is not high-income, high-end housing. Okay, this is low-income housing. So, how does all that work? How does that property development process actually work? Okay, and under what conditions can low-income communities use private funds efficiently without being exploited? I put this example of Oshiwara in Mumbai, where I've done a bit of work on that. And this large scale, you can see this is not small housing. This is a development of large scale housing driven by communities using funds from private banks. Okay? So under what conditions does that work, and under what conditions doesn't it work? We need to start thinking about those issues and coming to some kind of understanding of those relationships. My final question about the private sector is that the private sector now has moved lock, stock, and barrel into planning as planners of cities. Okay. Anybody recognize what that is? Have you seen pictures like that before?
Will that be or?
That's, yes, you should know.
New capital
of Cairo, okay. Produced by planners, I think, from somewhere in the Gulf. Yeah. They're not Egyptian, for sure. Yeah. And this is the kind of shiny, you recognize this kind of shiny glass structures, a very kind of Shanghai, Dubai type of vision as to what as a future city might look in Cairo. If I don't know any of you ever seen pictures or been to Cairo, but if you have, you'll know that this doesn't look anything like Cairo. Okay? So there's something else going on here. Okay, there's something else going on here, and this is really being driven by foreign planners and foreign capital. Goldman called it speculative urbanism, which is quite an interesting name, okay? Getting into not property developer, not at the small scale, but here at the scale of cities, of developing and growing cities, okay? And what we see is that this kind of, which the multiplication now of these kind of plans for different cities in different parts of the world, we see that it's either focused on city redevelopment itself or on the periphery of cities, growing new satellites, and, as in the case of the Cairo capital, just outside Cairo, in the periphery. And this kind of planning done by the private sector very much linked to the narratives of smart cities, eco-cities, all this new words, okay? really, I wanted to start thinking about words and what they mean. So here we have a whole new generation of words, okay, to reflect the future city and what planning can be involved, what planning is involved in. And I think we need to start asking ourselves, under what conditions can the private sector actually plan future cities? Who are the planners? And what kind of planning are we talking about? What part of the experience that we're having now with this kind of planning is that it completely avoids local planning. It's done by national or special entities that are created to do this. So the local planners get cut out of this deal, okay? Or they're only there to facilitate the market in different ways. So what kind of planning are we talking about? And what kind of places are we creating? Yeah? What kind of imaginaries of urban futures are we actually thinking about here? For me, critical question, whose city is this? Who's this for? Yeah? Who's this for? Because when I go back to those large areas of informal settlers, over 50% of Mumbai is informal settlement. In some African cities, it's up to 90%. Right? So who's that for? Because those people can't afford that glass and that all that stuff. Okay? So who's that for? And of course, ultimately, I think we've got to ask, is who pays for it? When I put pays, I don't just mean money. I mean who deals with the consequences of it. And we know already that some of the cities that have begun to be the beginnings of those cities, we've seen large-scale evictions of people, not always with compensation, okay? Huge, the taking up of agricultural land to build those areas on the periphery of cities. Many, many issues which are just simply being brushed under the carpet in the name of these kind of imaginings. So, a whole set of questions there. I think we need to ask us, that broadly speaking, under what conditions is the market an efficient and equitable distribution mechanism for essential goods and services and for the planning of cities? And we need to ask ourselves, what is the role of the state in creating and supporting these conditions? Okay? In other words, does the state have a role in managing the market in some way or not? Or what is its relationship to the market? Okay? And what is the role of organizations of poor communities in partnership with market-led organizations, which we're starting to see more and more of? So, there's one group I haven't talked about, and that's civil society. So I want fairly quickly to go through how much and what kind of civil society involvement in planning. And I think, of course, you'll tell me that this isn't an issue anymore. Okay? Communities as passive beneficiaries or active citizens in planned intervention. Well, maybe you'll say to me, no, of course it's active citizens. Okay? But I have to say to you that I come across planning every day that doesn't do that. Okay? So it seems to me it's still a question. It's still a question. And in the basic needs approach, we got a new word. You take it for granted now, community participation. You take it for granted. But in the 70s, it was a new word. Now, it came out of the basic needs approach. And it meant, and this was the debate at the time, are we talking about participation as an end in itself, as a political right, or are we just talking about participation as a means to achieve certain things, almost in a more instrumental way? Okay? Lots of debate and discussion around those things, and lots of debate and discussion around the difference between what people say they do and what actually happens in practice, rhetoric and practice. In other words, people say all sorts of good and wonderful things about community participation, but when you look at it in the practice, you sometimes find very contradictory things happening. In neoliberal thinking and participation in the era of structural adjustment, really participation has largely been treated as a means in a very instrumental way. But of course there's a reaction to that. There's a reaction to that by communities themselves. And we've seen the growth of social movements in different parts of the world, of communities organizing themselves and of taking positions against what governments are doing, private sector is doing. And indeed, I've been working with groups of people who I think have become community developers. In other words, I don't want to call them property developers, but they're actually community property developers. Because they reckon now, they don't want to hand that over to anybody. They want to do that themselves in their own interests, but working with other people in different ways. And here's some of the examples of fairly large scale development, housing developments in different parts of India in this case, where communities have actually challenged that idea of being passive beneficiaries, being actually very hands-on. So the important questions here is, under what conditions can communities decide and manage their own affairs? We know that that's not always possible all the time. So let's try and get a bit clever about this. Let's start to think, look at different contexts, begin to understand under what conditions can communities decide and manage their own affairs, and what is the role of the state in supporting those conditions? Does the state have any role in that at all? If so, what is it? I think there's another issue here. We often tend just to talk about communities as if they're somehow homogeneous, okay? And I think really the question is, when we want to, when states do want to involve communities, how do they do that in a way that recognizes diversity, that recognizes that not all people are the same? So communities are not homogeneous. They have many different social identities, and some of them have mobilized around those social identities. In other words, they become political entities around those social identities to campaign for change. And I think it's very important to start to look around and see what are the existing or emerging social movements in a locality and how are they organized, okay? And how, even within those movements, is diversity recognized? Right? Of course, communities mobilize around particular identities doesn't mean that they themselves also recognize the full diversity of people. So how is difference being recognized? Final question around civil society, I think, is a very important one, and one that the DPU in the last 5 years has been doing a huge amount of work. The knowledge and experience and aspirations of the so-called expert planner and the knowledge and experience and aspirations of communities. This is about questions of knowledge, of who holds knowledge. And I think the first step in this discussion is to recognize that planners, so-called experts, and their knowledge are not neutral. Okay? Our knowledge, as I started off by saying, reflects certain paradigms, certain positions, certain values. Okay? So we can't think of planning expertise as a technical, purely technical expertise. Okay? It's deeply political, and it's not neutral. We also have seen discussions in the last 10, 15 years about the importance of different kinds of knowledge. In other words, so-called scientific knowledge as against knowledge that is generated in everyday practices, everyday living of people. I think you talked a little bit about this in your first session. And this is something that becomes very important about whose knowledge counts. Whose knowledge counts in the planning process. So here we're talking about what are the relationships between planners and communities, and what assumptions and knowledge do they hold about each other? And who initiates, and where are decisions taken, and how are decisions taken, are some of the issues I think we need to think about. Enough questions, right? More than enough. So, in conclusion, I think we're talking here about planned intervention in the context of governance, which I've tried to stress, in other words, within the framework of political relations. Okay. We have referred to the importance of dominant paradigms, in other words, the dominance of particular development theories that have come out of thinking in the so-called global north, okay, and been institutionalized in international agencies. And a lot of recent debate has been about the challenge of co-option. In fact, that debate goes way back, really, because I think the dependency theorists of Latin America began to challenge all that a long time ago. And I think we start to see today new kinds of people talking about alternative paradigms here. Debates about so-called southern theory, in other words, theory which has its roots and origins in other parts of the world, okay? And the whole question of translocal learning, in other words, how people at local levels learn between cultures and between places. And indeed, a lot of debate and discussion about community-led practices rather than so-called expert-led or state-led practices. So there is a huge debate and discussion about these kind of more radical alternatives. I come back to this because I think you're going to have to come back to this through your year, and you're going to have to work, you pick your way through what this really means in the context of your course. In terms of the implications for planning theory, you know, what kind of planning theory are you looking at? Are you focusing on efficiency, equality, social justice? Equality and social justice with efficiency? Is that even possible? Okay. Transformation. I hear that word so often. I don't know if we know what it means anymore. Okay. What does it mean? Okay. Implications for methodology. Do you think the scientific method is the best way, the only way to go? Or do you think that there are other ways in which we can do planning and base the things we do on planning? What does participation of citizens really mean for planning methodology? Yeah? Big questions. What we know in relation to practice is this relation between theory and methodology debates will in some way strengthen practice. I believe that. And it just so happens I come back to evaluation. Because I think evaluation is about learning, should be about learning. Okay? And it's that link between theory, methodology, and practice that we need to develop the capacity to learn about those relationships to improve what we do. What we do, I think, should be generated on what we call in the DPU a reflexive practice, a practice which implies a critical understanding of your position, of the kind of work you do, of the values you hold, of the paradigms you inhabit. Okay? And we would argue that one of the things we'd like to do by the end of the year is to turn out reflexive practitioners. That you become reflexive practitioners, that you at least understand the dimensions of that and work with that in a very, very real way and go into your future practice with those kinds of principles driving what you do. I've tried to emphasize, and I do this again in answering the many questions that I've put, you need to recognize and address the traveling of planning ideas and practices in the world. And that it's a world in which we confront many different power relations. But ideas like smart cities, eco-cities, all these nice words, they travel all over. And they sit here and they sit there. And I think what I'm saying to you is, you need to understand where it comes from. And what is it doing there? And who is it benefiting? And who's involved in that process? In other words, begin to understand and address this traveling of planning ideas. We can't get away from the fact that one of the most fundamental historical realities that planning lives with today is the impact of the colonial era on planning. Because in the colonial era, British planning was set up in different parts of the world. And even today, if you go and you look at the legislation planning, you realize that it reflects a thinking of the 1930s in the British planning system. Okay? So in other words, we live with that traveling ideas of planning all the time. Okay? okay? And we need to start addressing it and to understanding what it means. I would like to think, for me, of planning as the mobilization of hope. I know that's very ambitious, but I believe in it. Okay. And I hope by the end of the year, you'll feel some of that too. Thank you very much.